Yeah. We just came from a Balinese birthday party. And so that explains the frangipani in my hair. And it was said, the legend said that the most famous flute player in Bali was there celebrating this guy's birthday because he knew him. So we got a couple songs of amazing flute playing. I mean, it was incredible. In this half traditional, half modern gamelan orchestra, which is this Balinese, traditional Balinese music. I mean, if you listen to it, it has almost no melody, but in it's, I think only men play. I've only seen men play gamelan. And then perfect synchronization, perfect. It's an incredible thing to witness. So I've taken a couple of videos. Maybe I send them in the group. But we met a taxi driver said, "Oh yeah, I'm the chief orchestra of the gamelan in this village next to us." And we said, "Well, how do you become chief orchestra of the gamelan?" And he said, it was you don't practice it. It's a taksu. It's my taksu." And so we were asking, "What is a taksu?" And he said, "Well, it's the talent. It's I mean, he couldn't really explain it, but it's something like the talent, the knack, the what you're born to do in the village." So what he was born to do was to be this orchid, like orchid, and he's this 40 people in the gamelan orchestra. And so Clinton says, "Well, how often, do you meet and rehearse?" And he says, "Oh, we don't rehearse. We just come and
Play.
play." He says, "Well, how do you know the songs?" He says, "Because it's your taksu."
It's his text.
Yeah, but also the other people, it's their taksu, and that's how you know the song. And I mean, we thought, God, this white people's culture is really sad. This is kind of the space we were in just right now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
Thank
you.
you. So beautiful. You both of you still radiate so much joy and aliveness. It's so beautiful to see. Thank you.
Trying to share it with you guys.
Okay.
Is anybody coming here in this space with something?
Yes.
Good. Go.
I did the disjointment process. I asked for a space holder.
Disjointment.
And yeah, what I experienced is I experienced the time before the disjointment. And in that time, there was no need unfulfilled. Everything was taken care of. And this is basically me remembering, my body's remembering a time when some things were different. And the changes I experienced since then is, it's hard for me to explain it. I would say I feel more peaceful and more at ease. If these are the right words, like it's not that complicated like before. And even though it's on the other hand, it's more intense, some things, but I don't know. This is the way to explain it right now for me. And I'm very grateful for that. I'm very thankful, feel joy.
Can you,
Thank you.
Christopher, can you say why you feel joy? I mean, most people, facing an inner structure like that, or just even having this conversation, would feel really disturbed or upset, and could you just try to convey where the joy is coming from?
Yeah, I feel joy because I feel more connected to myself. And it's somehow that I have new abilities in relating spaces. New abilities meaning I can more relate more easily. And it's not this fight going on inside of me, which is blocking.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Thank you for your courage to do that. It's, who held space for you?
Gabriela.
Oh, great. Fagundes?
Yes.
Oh, great. Yeah, super. Great.
And I will write something down. I just took my time. It was before Christmas. And I was just enjoying the new me, let's call it, the new experience. And,
great way to say it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. We're practicing no dead time. So if you have something to say, just cut off, interrupt. I've been working today on finishing up a new book title for Thoughtware Press. It's called Four Feelings by Valerie Langford. It started off being a pamphlet, and I added a few articles that she wrote over the years. And those articles are really powerful distinctions. And one of the distinctions has to do with just, which one did I want to say about? How valuable it is to, be in, like, in the moment, basically. And that means that there's these injunctions. They call them injunctions. People have these injunctions in their mind. It's like a voice, but it's more powerful. It's like wired in, and it says, you know, don't be you, don't be present, don't be big, don't speak out, don't show up, don't, you know, don't contribute, you know, don't participate. Like, all these things are these injunctions. And we get them in stressful situations and forget that it's not reality. And it's just a trick from our survival strategy, which was probably useful back then for a short time. But then we forget that we made this vow to ourselves to not show up, not participate. And it's valuable. Anyway, I'm really glad to be able to share these distinctions with you in the book. And I think they'll just be really useful for everybody to, because once you get the injunction, what your injunctions are, what, you know, what your drivers are, you just go, hey, oh God, that's the driver again. And you just drive around it like a, you know, some dog poop on the sidewalk, you know, you just walk around it. And then once you know the poop is there, and now you know why your feet have been stinking in the house, you know, because, but now you know it's there, you can walk around it. And so there's just really valuable distinctions in the book. I'm really glad to be getting it out there. So thank you.
I'll practice the no dead time. And something along the line of what Clinton was talking about is, I just started this fear club last Saturday, or is this 38 people all together, and maybe five or six in that group who are doing it in delay because they're in Brazil and it's late. And somehow I've had this wish to create the legends about Fear Club. Like, one of my wish from this Fear Club is, how do we create the legend about Fear Club? Because I know, Nicole, you're going to be holding one soon. And also there's one in Portuguese with Patricia and Daniele Barros. And I've been sad and scared and angry that there's not the legends of Fear Club. But like, people don't relate to Fear Club the same way they relate to Rage Club. It's like Rage Club.
Rage,
you know,
Club is, yeah!
Yeah! You know, let's go rage together. And Fear is like, no! That's not Jesus. And for now, I mean, the discovery, one of the main discoveries is, how can we use fear to hit bottom? So I thought, God, that's not really a legend that I want to put out there. Come to Fear Club and you'll hit bottom. It's like, no. And at the same time, there's this really this joy. I think what Christopher, you were talking about, or this joy of, finally I can be where I am. Mm. Like, finally the show is, you know, it's over. I don't have to pretend. I don't have to be good. I don't have to. And that's really what's possible at hitting bottom. And yes, it's intense. Like, there's huge feelings, fears, but also sadness and anger and also joy. And so there's this paradox of this, yeah, this process that we're going into together, this paradox of hitting bottom and actually finding life at the bottom. And Clinton wrote a website a couple of days ago that came out of a conversation right after the Fear Club on Saturday. And I recommend reading it. It's really a brilliant, genius website.
Which is called?
Hit Bottom. Hit bottom and stay there.
If somebody says what you are, you can say, I'm a bottom dweller. I'm a bottom feeder. Nicole, were you going to say something?
I love that. I remember this thing about hitting rock bottom and then staying there, building your home there. Because so then you don't go up into some fantasy pretend version of reality again. You get to be with reality. And I've been wanting to say something about Ingrid held space for me a week or so ago, which is a legend in itself. Like you would, I mean, it would be easy for people to assume that Ingrid can't hold space anymore, but she can and she does. And yeah, in the process,
she can say yes, she can say no, she can say fuck you. Make it stop. No.
She can just say, it's like just looking at her, you kind of get it. What is coming? And then, yeah, anyway, find out for yourself. And it was a little bit like a diaphragm process because I had so many, I could sense so many icky old fears in my diaphragm, and I started pulling them out. And she said, keep going until you find your gremlin joy that's stuck there too. And it was like, whoa.
Whoa.
I got to this gremlin joy, and it was so heartbreaking and so fine. It was like finally saying those things that my gremlin had said long ago is how I kind of get how it went. And then the fear just like glommed on to say those kinds of things again. My gremlin had all these superior comparison competitive things to say, like joy about how I'm better than you and I can be, I'm more beautiful you, and he wants me more than he wants you, and all this comparative stuff. And finally like owning it. Or and then also it changed my relationship, my deal with my gremlin, that because then my gremlin would also be trying to stop me from saying those things, punishing me for thinking those things, and because they got me in big trouble. And then my deal with my gremlin is now that instead of bashing me about that stuff, coaching me. And I thought it would take a lot of reminders and stuff. Like, and we found out he needed reminders to be able to do it. And so we made this deal and I set up these reminders, and he's just been coaching me. It's so cool. Like, mm-hmm, it's happening. And it's a lot like I heard you saying, Christopher, it's similar. It's like, I can just be different. I can just skip the bullshit. Like, it's so cool not to have that stinky thing you were talking about, Clinton, happening, where go ahead and have my life how I want it. And it's so cool. And I'm here in love with my mother building a bridge house. And I mean, some of you might not think that, or might not really be able to get how incredible it is to be able to say I'm in love with my mother. But I am. She's so cool, you guys. She's an edge worker ahead of her time, and I get to hear all these stories about how my grandmother is also an edge worker ahead of her time, who is like, it's just so great. I'm so glad.
Wow.
So glad, because I didn't have the experience of having had a mother who loved me. I didn't have that experience until I was 52 years old. And now I get to have it every day. It's really cool.
Wow, thank you for that. What a celebration. Wow. Wow. You know, immediately want to ask, can you record her? Can you interview her? Or, you know, have Julia Neumann interview her, or somebody, Martina Ricarda from Germany, like just record some of those stories, because it sounds like really amazing stuff. And again, I've been getting stories from the 70s and 80s in the work from Valerie Lankford, and it's a wake-up call, like how much courage these people had, and at the same time, what we are standing on to be where we are now. Because, you know, these guys were going first, and there was nothing. You know, they had Freud, you know, and that's all they had, you know, and then they had to come up with, real stuff and wild experiments, and really documenters, like really the documenters was what we're standing on, is the ones who documented that stuff. So I really appreciate the documentation work that people do. Thank you for that, Nicole.
Well.
Who's up?
I went through a surgery, an operation. I was in hospital, and I decided to leave it as an extraordinary moment. I created we were in an extraordinary space, and it was very enjoyable. It was I felt so alive. With little things. For example, my neighbor was watching news all the time, political news, really modern world. And I just have this sensation, it was a sensation of anger. Asked him to put it lower, he didn't. Thought about possibilities, earplugs, navigated the sadness of the hospital, of there's so much death feeling. It was the largest hospital in Lisbon, next to the largest shopping mall in Lisbon, next to the largest stadium in Lisbon, next to the bank headquarters, and facing me. And just facing me in my room, there was this big photo of a tree, and it's a photo of a tree and a drawing from a Portuguese artist, which I edited her book because it was about trees. And it was this echo, magical moment. And I lived everything like a sensation of being alive, because I was receiving reflexology. I decided not to take any painkillers. Mm-hmm. And it was a sensation of being alive. It was like a party. I enjoyed every pain. And I thought about you, Ingrid. And I thought about when we were here. And I thought one of the feelings I had is like, Ingrid, the expression you have when you're here of joy of everything, you mastered a way of expressing yourself that is so precious to me, really precious, really. I thought a lot about PM during that time, because it would have been completely different if I hadn't done it. And afterwards, I've been enjoying this pain in the physical body as a way of being alive, of and seeing how much fear is psychological, and was very special.
I
also had various thoughts how I come here with a child ego state, and it's a good way to work with the notion of the not knowing. How do I approach it? The not knowing. Either just not knowing, just accepting that I don't know, or just wanting to be accepted and being in a child ego state.
You know, there's not much distance at all between one ego state and another. And it's probably more of a choice, a personal choice about which ego state you're in than most people think. And so nobody does not have a child ego state. Everybody has that. Just like everybody has a closet. But you don't have to live in the closet. You know, there's a whole big house out here. Or you don't have to live in the front entryway of your house where the umbrellas are and the shoes are. You don't have to live in the mudroom. You can live in the whole house. So in the value of nothingness in the adult ego state is so immense, it's hard to even describe. I mean, most of the work of possibility management is trying to bring people into the experience of the value of nothingness as a force of creation. And so the not knowing and the nothingness is so valuable. Mm. And you can step out of the closet into the adult ego state and start looking at nothing and emptiness and not knowing from the adult ego state. And it is a giant dance floor. It's like a giant magician's laboratory. And it's a huge space for interaction and for invention and for creation. And so I encourage you to notice, yes, I have a child ego state, and I've been there frequently, but just like having a closet, you don't have to go and live in the closet. You can say, okay, I know where the closet is. I'm going to try something else. But they're very close together, these ego states.
Mm. Thank you.
You're welcome. Somebody else.
Yeah, I'm asking myself how to step out of this closet, because yesterday I was doing a practice of letting my heart speak. I met with other women for 1 hour, and I'm sensing the same thing that I sensed yesterday. It's like, it's something, somehow I'm protecting my heart. I'm sensing that my heart is really hurting right now here in this space. Like I built somehow a shield so I can, and I feel really sad about it.
So the heart can only hurt in four different ways. So
fear. You,
what? Fear?
I feel fear, yeah. I feel this emotional fear kicks in, and then I'm building a buffer zone between me and you.
Yeah. What's the problem with feeling the fear?
In connection.
I could destroy it.
Destroy what?
Destroy the connection.
I don't think so. Try it.
I don't like. It's a bullshit fear.
Well, you don't have to judge it. It's not about judging it. It's about really feeling. like you started to do, you said, I first I feel sad. And then you said, it's because my heart is aching, you know, and then you said you built this thing on top of your heart, but then what's underneath is the fear. So it was easy for you to just take the thing that you built and just put it aside. You know, it's like taking a blanket off when you're on a bed, you just throw it aside. You can do that. And then you let the fear come up and it was like, okay, yes, this is hitting bottom. This is connecting with fear, with us, with your fear. And you can scream, you can freak out, you can pull your fingers going like whatever. And we're still going to be connected with you. So it's really about just taking the covers off and just, you know, being raw, being like there. And I mean, that's what this space is really about. It's about this radical relating, which is just say, you know, saying what it is and being what it is, you know. And so Ingrid's been, you know, everybody who's spoken, Christopher, Antonio, you know, everybody has been seeking, Nicole, they're really experimenting with that, and you're doing the same. And so hello.
Hello.
What's your fear sharing with us? What's the fear about? Or is it something else now?
Now I feel fear because everyone's looking at me.
What's the problem? What's the fear about really?
That you don't love me, that...
Okay, hold on, let's check.
Okay.
How many people have, not just now, but for a while, had a sense that they love Isabel? I don't think these people are lying. I don't think these people are making this up. Try to let it in, Isabel. It doesn't go away when we turn the screen off.
We put our hands down.
Or when we put our hands down. What else do you need? You know, you could start over the rest of your life from this moment. Can you take a screenshot? If everybody put your hand up, can you take a screenshot, Isabel? Just take a screenshot.
Yes, I can.
You what?
Make a screenshot. I made really a screenshot on my computer.
Yeah, and like 3 times a day, pull up the screenshot and look at each person's eyes, check their heart, scan them out, and just let it in. And this could be the beginning of the rest of your life. I'm not trying to be like a Walmart card or whatever it's in, Hallmark card. I'm trying to just say, really, you get to start over. This is what start over is about. We go on these journeys together and we get into this place. And at that place, you can start over and you don't ever have to, you can't go back. I don't know, did you ever go on a journey, like a hike or a walk or to a different country or whatever, and you go back and thinking you can have the similar or same experience, and it's not the same at all. Anybody have that? You know?
Yes.
Restaurants are closed, wrong people, it's raining, whatever.
Or even if everything's the same, it's like, I'm different. So yeah. Whatever I liked before, I don't like it anymore.
So you can't really go back, but you can start over. And that's what we're doing for each other. Making a new foundation at a new place, you can start again, start over. And so Isabel, you can start over with 15 or 16 people love you for no reason. Happy birthday.
Thank you.
And then it's like that. the radical relating is, you know, you do, like Clinton was inviting Isabel to do it, it's like, oh, what's now? Okay, I'm afraid of this. Okay, or is it accurate? You know, is this still valid? And you check in this case, okay, that wasn't valid. The second fear, it wasn't valid. And then there will be the next thing. There will be the next thing. And so, okay, well, then say the next thing. And eventually, you know, in the beginning, it might be in these practices of letting your heart speak, it might be these, all these things that you didn't check before, like all these feelings, like, are they still valid? But then eventually something else shows up.
Like what?
More presence, like more from now, like more from nothing, maybe more from that your heart. Anyway, this is, I think, it's our feelings is really this, let's say, I don't know about a channel, but this connector, this like the electricity for the other resources to come through us. Like without the feelings, they can't really speak. They can't really move us. We don't have this energy, the information. And so then the feelings are more about being this electricity that jacks us into these other places in us. It's not just this emotional things that needs to be checked.
You know, we've got a lot of experiential clarity about bright principles, for example. And we have a lot of experiential clarity about archetypal lineage, for example. And those things are knocking on our door. And as soon as you're okay with being present and having feelings, then they can talk to you or move through you. And so part of the impulses that you'll get when you get present in a small now and it's okay to feel stuff is you'll start getting instructions of how things go. You know, what's the next experiment? And like last week, Jeff Shipp there was telling us about trying some experiments and they just hit the wall, just like splash into the helicopter blades and just like make a mess or fall apart or just disintegrate for no reason or whatever the thing is. And then there could be this tendency to go, well, I'm not going to do experiments anymore. You know, I'm going to go get a job, whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's where we were last week, is having this conversation that all of us have had. You know, I'm just going to not be an experimenter anymore. And I've certainly had it plenty of times. And it's like the resources, it starts off, it's so easy to turn off a television. You know, you just walk over and push the button and the television's gone. But it's also easy to turn it back on. And so that's our connection to our resources, is really that easy to turn off and turn on. And it isn't, if you're hooked, you know, if you get hooked into a reactivity and you don't know it's a reactivity, and then, or something gets triggered or something like that, then you won't find the turn on switch for your resources. And that's where it's really great to have friends. And they go, give me your hand, and they go, bring it over here and click. And you go, ah, you know, it's like, it's really like that. And how many people have had that your friends will do this for you? You're in a total mess. Yeah, and the friends just come over and just go, hey, it's like this. And you go, oh, all right. Yeah. So that's the point of three cells. It's a point of possibility teams and spark study groups and this study group, and like it's a point of all the workshops and
bridge houses.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, that's a major.
You live in it.
yeah. So thank you. Are you okay, Isabel? You want to say anything else?
Yes. I want to share something, because yesterday I was walking down the street and a woman started talking to me, and then after a time she looked at me and said, are you the one who is doing spiritual surgeries? And I said, and I talked to her, like, you're living there in this purple acai house, and I know, I heard from you, and I'm living here in this really small town. Like, we have 600 people. We don't have we just have streets of sand and earth, and my drinking water, I have to go like 1 kilometer to fill it on. And it's like really the eggs I get from the neighbor, the milk I get from the other person, it's really small. And we have one WhatsApp group all together. Where you can say, WhatsApp, yeah, you can say, like, I need eggs, who has eggs? And then someone just, yeah. So it's really small, so the people talk. And before, I was the German one. And they had a lot of stories because I'm not smiling all the time. If people say bon dia, tudo bem, I tell them how I am. And so they thought this is German. and now I'm the spiritual surgerist.
It's been an upgrade. So did you say yes? What can I do for you?
Yes. This is what I said.
We can do brain splits, we do mind machines, we do energetic blocks, we just whatever you need, you got it. Ah, thank you. Pretty soon you can walk down the street and go, Harvey Gar! No, people will start. Oh yeah, the spiritual surgeon is giving us the mantra. Thank you. Sophia, are you speaking?
Yes. This is the first time. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
We are.
This is the first time I participate. I had the impulse to come here. I was here struggling with this. I have to do some like creative work, some text for my site. And also there is a lot of things to deal with, like bureaucratic. And I just felt this heart impulse to join you. Because last week also I listened to a part of the recording when Jeff was talking and it touched me so much. And I want to stop and I want to have this moment of connection with other beings. And I want to be in this true space. So I had the impulse to join. And then there was this mind thing, oh, but you have things to do and what are you doing? Like, and it was like not possible to stop the impulse. So I just joined.
Sophia, where are you calling from?
Lisbon.
Thank you.
And this is quite new for me, following the impulse.
What you can say is I feel
joy because I said yes to this inside impulse.
Yeah, you know, history changes with people who say yes. You know, when you say no, nothing changes. But if you say yes, whole new things can happen. What's the secret that we should know about you? What's the secret that we should know about you?
The secret, I really want to be connected with other beings. That's the thing that keeps me alive. That's like the more alive I can be is where I am connecting to other people in a space of truth.
What is What is your secret for connecting with people in a space of truth? What is your trick, your secret, your skill? What is that? How do you do it?
I think there is love and sadness. And when you were asking, when you said, I feel, and I was like, is it joy or is it sadness? There is like a lot of joy, but it kind of also comes with this sadness for
It works a lot better if you say, and not say there is, but if you say, I feel.
Yeah.
Not in the third person, speak from yourself. So just start over and say, I feel, just say that, not there is.
I feel joy because I am saying the truth from inside my heart.
This makes the universe happy, I'm telling you. Makes your bright principles happy, your archetypal lineage happy, echo happy, the void happy, makes everything happy when you do that.
Yeah.
Maybe not your mother.
What?
I don't know. I mean, talk to Nicole about how she can speak the truth with her mother and they are happy together. They love each other because they speak the truth together now.
Yeah, it touched me a lot, Nicole, when I listened to you. And I feel sad because there is this longing for that connection.
Here's another secret. Even when you have the connection, you can still long for the connection. You get this? Anybody noticed that before? You're in the connection, you're experiencing the connection, you're longing for the connection. Anybody noticed that before? So longing for the connection does not mean you don't have the connection. It's a quality of the connection is the longing.
And it just, it's not, you're not saying longing for a different connection.
No.
Different from this, that one.
For that connection, yeah. Yeah, Sophia, thank you. Did you want to say something else?
No, that's it.
It was nice to hear your voice. It was great. Put your hands down, Sophia. Put your hands down. We're talking to you. Try to keep your eyes open. Move your face close to the screen. We're saying thank you. Just try to let it in like Isabel was doing. Welcome to the space. Welcome to the conversation.
That's a movie quote.
We're not going there. Beth, go ahead.
Yes, I could not stay away from the study group after listening to the recording last week. I listened to the recording twice and it was like, I went liquid. I rewound to certain parts just to go through the experience again, particularly yes, when Jeff shared in people's reflections. And Clinton, you said something about if you are afraid of someone and you act afraid of someone, it's doing so much harm. And that really moved me. I feel like it shifted me into a parallel version of myself in a way. And yeah, I'm sad right now just to be talking to you and be here. It was the frequency of like family, the call last week. People were just saying how, oh, thank goodness I can come here and be with you all. And I had that longing. So I came today because I longed to be with you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Beth.
Thank you, Beth.
Beth, I want to encourage you to take the next step, okay? The next step is say the next thing. Like you're speaking really close to the bottom right now. And hold close to your heart, close to the bottom, and just let that thing speak. Just doesn't have to have any, don't even know what it's going to be before you speak, okay? Just say it.
Yes, I want to be in person with you people. I want to live in a bridge house and be in person in the energetic fields with you and speak and write and play and experiment with these things with you all and grow gardens and make food from our land and tend to trees and creatures and just be with you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I love elephant story.
Hold you on. We're not going there yet. Just hold on. And Antonio, there's somebody else who needs to speak to right now. Okay, can you just hold it for a while? Yeah, good. Beth, where do you live right now?
I'm in Boston at my sister's house. And I live with my sister and my niece.
Are you nomadic or you really live there?
I've been more nomadic.
Okay.
But my things are here, my truck, my clothing.
Because I know Nicole is setting up a bridge house. And
yeah, Beth, I have a space in this room for a bed for a woman to come and stay, and there's no requirement about how long it can be open to experiment to, because this is a seed. This room in this bigger house is a bridge house seed. And I don't know where the bridge house will be yet, but it'll be near. And there's a garden, it needs tending. And there's this edge worker, 82-year-old edge worker woman who happened to give birth to me to get to discover and hear from and really like learn how to be with an elder too, who's in the golden years of her life, and to bring her legacy forward a little bit more so that when she leaves, she can, you know, can say a really great goodbye. And I'm learning how to do that. And I'm learning how to do a lot of village weaving too. And I think you'd be a great addition. Will you come? Will you come and live in the bridge house with me in this bridge house
scene? I do not know. I don't know right now. And thank
Vera,
you.
And Vera down
let
there.
Let it cook.
Vera has
yes.
a bridge house running in Brazil. And it's all these women in someplace in Brazil.
Buenopolis.
Raise your hand if you're coming to the bridge house.
Oh, whoa.
Oh, whoa.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that's another option. Isn't it wonderful to have options for you to choose?
Wonderful.
So cool. Do you see what happened? Like Beth hit bottom and then she let her heart speak or soul speak, whatever. And she says this thing from her. And then these doors just open up. And they're not just doors. They're perfect doors. They're really perfect. And okay, how do you accept going through a perfect door? Well, it freaks you out at first that the universe works like that. That if you say what you want, finally the universe goes, finally they're saying what they want. Here it is. Here you go. You know? And then what?
Just to be clear, Clinton, I think that's the box. Ah! That's the box. The spirit doesn't do that. The spirit is like,
thank you. Great. Yeah, so let your box, you know, go with the compost, you know, let it compost and just move from that place that spoke. You know, and people who move like that, universe just supports them. Like you really get supported. So anyway, it's experiment time. You opened the door, Beth, so have fun.
Thank you.
So Anna Rudolph, who, or Marina, one of you guys.
Gaius,
thank you. Thank you. Neither one unmuted themselves. Vera, No thinking. Jocelyn.
I'm just going to go. I don't know. And
talking. Just talk instead of talking.
Happening. Okay. And yeah, I'm so glad to be going to the Bridge House and in Brazil. I just finalized my tickets yesterday. And yesterday in the morning, I went to this asynchronous fear club with some of the women in the Bridge House. And I didn't know how much fear I was going to feel extra at the beginning when they all sat down in front of me to have a talk with me about what was going on, that I hadn't booked my tickets yet. And I realized how much it's great. Like all the things that have been being mentioned on this call is like, I see myself battling myself to stay in the present, because I like keep going back to these emotional fears or future fears and, you know, things coming up about Jeff and being physically apart, because we've literally only physically been together since we got together. And we explored it last night at this date night space that we held. And it was really amazing because in talking it out, I realized like, there's such a mix of things going on about it. Like I feel so much joy to like give myself this gift to go, you know, be with myself, to be with women, you know, apart, to sort of have a breather, if you will, like to take this space and to do something different. And then I also realized, you know, how much fear there is about, you know, what we might discover being apart, you know, like, even if it's like, I actually realized how much I really care for you. And in that, I, you know, if you find something, whatever it else, like if you don't want to come back together, it's like, I want for you what you want for you. And that's really scary. And also the same for me. So I just really at the edge about that. So it's a lot of things that are alive about it for me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's interesting to notice how close fear and aliveness are. And Antonio was talking about it, you know, people were talking about, if you finally let the fear come, there's this aliveness that comes with it. And that's not an accident. It's really, and think of how many people you know who numb their fear and don't look very alive. You know, a lot of people put their face in their phone, you know, and they're just distracted in their mind and they're numbing their fear. How alive do they look? And there's so many ways to numb it out. And so, I mean, I love this video with Mr.
Ramesh.
Huh?
Ramesh.
Ramesh. Mr. Ramesh is called. Look at my body shaking. I'm alive. I'm alive.
I'm afraid. I'm alive.
With this great video. And it's a few minutes. It's in the Possibility Management TV channel. And it's so true. And so it's just a bizarre thing because your parents don't do this. You know, no teachers at school didn't say, okay, now I'm going to show you what it's like to be alive. Ah, you know, the teachers didn't do this. You know, people are all trying to be cool or numb, or and it's just, but it's a revolution happening. It's a revolution happening.
I mean,
so,
I have to say, Fear Club is a revolution.
Fear Club is a revolution. So, you know, Isabel, your whole town is going to start walking down the street going, I'm alive! I'm alive! The video. Thank you. Thank you, Jacqueline.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Marina, you're muted.
Yeah, I'm muted. I discovered today in the Let Your Heart Speak that every time that I was going to my heart, I was feeling pain. And that was the mechanism, because I was going to my heart and I would feel pain.
What do you mean?
Even joy, all four feelings, pain.
Okay.
I experienced joy. I was like going to there, and then I would feel the physical pain also in my heart. And then when you say that, I can see clearly that, like, while I was expressing that feeling, four feelings coming from that pain, I start to say from my heart.
Mm-hmm.
And I was actually avoiding that pain. So every time that I was speaking from my heart, I would avoid that pain and I would go back to my heart, my mind again. And that was the mechanism. And I've discovered today, it's like I discover in my body how much this can prevent me from life, from being alive, from connection, from... And with the experiment with Isabel, like at the beginning, she was feeling the pain and we couldn't have any information coming from her, energy. The energy couldn't come to us. And then when she went to the pain, then I could see Isabel, and then she illuminate, and then she brought this village story, like, and I am experiencing this, like I'm feeling a lot of pain, and I will stay with that. I will stay with that.
I want to say something.
Go ahead.
Which is often my experience is the physical pain that's attached to the emotional pain. The physical pain is because you're not feeling those feelings. And so the heart has physical pain if you're not feeling them.
It has to go, it has to hold it back. And that's painful.
And so as you learn to let your heart speak and let them flow almost really immediately, really in the heart, the when the heart speaks, it's a different vocabulary. It might be slower, but it's fast in the way that there's the feeling and the information, and the feeling and the information, and it flows like that. And I think the pain will just, the physical pain will soon, really, really soon go away.
You just saw Beth do it tonight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it has, there is so much there, Marina, and you can, do you have somebody who's in, like, who are you doing that with? Who's listening right now for you? Do you have somebody to listen to with you? Every day, you know, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, every day, do you have somebody right now?
No.
Okay, what if you ask somebody in here? Say, will somebody partner up with me for the next few weeks? Every day we're going to talk for 5 or 10 minutes. I'm going to let my heart speak and you listen. Do you want to ask that?
Yeah, my impulse is to ask Habet will be the bridge house with me. Would you be my partner for that?
Your rice and bean.
Yay.
And then Habet, you do it in return, you know, you do it also.
Back and forth.
Yeah, back and forth.
It's not so long. It's not discussion. It's not sharing time. It's a let the heart speak time. It's like 7 minutes, like it's less than 15 minutes, the whole call. 10 or 15 minutes. Okay, you guys?
Yeah.
Okay.
When does the bridge house start?
Thank you.
In 15 days.
Okay. On the first.
Okay.
Wow. So, Beth, you like, what's that place?
Rice and bean.
Where is it?
Cabo Verde.
Cabo Verde. Beth, it's three. You got three.
Now. I could bring my niece. I could bring my niece with me, right? Isn't it for kids?
All you got to do is say yes. You know, it's like Sophia, right? Said yes
to us.
Yeah, she said yes to something.
I'm sure she did.
Saying yes opens up a new thing. Wow, thank you. Anybody else right now?
Beth, I want to ask you if you want to do the heart practice with me.
Yes.
Like Marina and Habet are doing.
Okay. Yes, Isabel, I do.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I wanna just say something. I don't know what's coming out, but yeah, when I heard you speak about the heart, to let the heart speak, I just noticed an experiment that I'm actually doing since some weeks, and I want to share it here, which is when I'm noticing that I'm in my mind, or I'm identified with my emotions, or I'm in, like, on the way to the swamp, or even in the swamp, I put my attention on my chest, like on my heart space. And it has, something has evolved in the last weeks, and it's some kind of energy that I'm noticing in that space. And it's like a little bit like falling in love, and at the same time being eaten up by this love, like as if I would give some of this fakeness that is happening in the moment when I'm focusing on that, as if it was feeding something. And I have the sense that it's something like something is shifting magically, and I cannot get hold of it, but I'm just really feeling the energy in that space circulating and something shifting. And it, yeah, I just want to share that also for other people who sometimes find themselves like too much in their mind, maybe, and maybe there's not the moment to have a check-in or to call someone or to be with other people to really put the attention on the chest, on the heart space, and see what happens.
A proposal on are you doing any work talks soon? Like in the next week or two or three? No.
What?
I
see Vera smiling.
Plan out three work talks in the next 3 or 4 weeks. And it doesn't matter how many people are there, but you put them out in your circle, you tell, you know, everybody that you're doing this and you stand up there. And if you need a first sentence, and Chloe's really good with first sentences, didn't used to be, but now she is, and, or Vera, and then you say, give me a first sentence. Then you stand up and you just let this thing talk to people. You look at people, and you just let this thing talk. Just, that's all.
Can you, Clinton, can you repeat the last sentence? My internet just broke.
If you want the first sentence, say, Clinton, can you give me a first sentence?
You get your work talk, you have your first sentence, and in that first sentence, you just look at the people at the work talk, and you let this thing speak to them. And you don't think about it. It's kind of a blessing, but it's like, what I'm saying is, it's like a fire hose, you know, like on a fire truck. So you have this fire hose and you're trying to point it at yourself. And that's not great. It doesn't really work that way. You take the fire hose and you point it at other people and you just let this stuff go through. And then it gets put to good use. Because right now, the way you spoke, what you're going to do with that is circulate it around in your body, and that's not going to help anybody. You think those sources, the resources, want that to go through you like a transformer to other people and other things, you know, just like to go through you. And so you can arrange a work talk really easily, and you just set it up and people are there and you just let it go through you and record the work talks. And you can do really valuable stuff with that. But if you try to circulate it through you, it's old technology. It's old technology, it's tantric, whatever shit. So in this job, the work is service. You arrange the space to be the space through which those resources can go through you and do its work in the world. So will you do that?
Yes, I will do that.
Great. Just announce what you're doing. If you need your first sentences, that's the title of your work talk, is the first sentence. So and do that, you know, in the next day or so. And then you, and it'll happen. And then you have a place for this stuff to go. It's really great. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. But the fire hose needs to be used, you know, and just use it. Yeah, don't waste the water. Thanks.
Great. Thank you. I feel fear and I'm glad.
Yay.
Yes.
Anybody else, anything else right now, except the elephant story?
I just want to say it's a great to be in a culture where somebody says, I feel fear, and it's a celebration. Yeah. Instead of, I feel fear, I'm not going to do it. Yeah.
Anything else? Go ahead.
Yes. I'm here, and I've feel a lot of joy and sadness of being not just, yeah, when that we celebrate when someone says, I feel fear, but also that this is more a village than a lot of villages, and we're not even physically together. And I'm here. And everything that's happening in this side, on this side, it feels really similar. I'm in love with you guys. I feel sad and glad. I feel sad because you are here and that you want to meet and we are here. And it's not, there's, it's like just this space, this has no, there's no, it's not about performing. And I've been letting go a lot of this part of performing.
Don't go in your back, stay looking at people, keep talking. Stay close to the bottom, keep going. Keep looking at people, keep talking.
Yeah.
I feel sad.
I feel sad. I feel sad. I feel sad because you're here and that you're wanting to be close to your heart. And I want to be close to my heart with you. And that there's nothing to achieve. I love that there's nothing to achieve here. Or to perform. And that you're looking at me and that you're not expecting anything from me. And I'm not expecting anything from me. And I'm scared because I am also practicing the letting my heart speak from the bottom. And when it kind of goes into sadness mostly at the moment. But my fear is that it's this there's some bigger thing that comes out and I'm scared of that bigness because I can't control it anymore. I can't even foresee anything, and so. And I want that too. I want that too. But I'm not forcing it to come out anymore. Mm. So I'm here just kind of like a listening space. And then if it comes, I'll say more.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Jeff, I think it's your turn.
Yeah, last week I talked about like crawling back, you know, and it just hit me now that actually echo is like moving me back, moving me not backwards back, but moving me back to where I came from. Like at the date night last night, a man from my childhood, he was there with his wife. And it's the first time that somebody from there comes to a space. And they're so in and so lost. And like, it was amazing to have Nicole there, to have you there working together. It was so wild. And yeah, and then in the Gremlin transformation, that I was given the challenge to just start calling people, And I've been calling a lot of people, and then another man from my, you know, from one of my best friends from childhood, he reached out to me and sent me this text about how he's so sorry that he's been like ignoring me and moving away, and that he wants to have a call. And so we booked a call today. And yeah, I just can't believe it. You know, I'm not trying to believe it. And there's all these things that are moving me, and it's crazy. It's crazy. And then I heard Antonio, I'm still hooked on what you shared about going to surgery and rejoicing in every moment of it. So like, wow, I didn't even think that I could have that as a possibility from when I was working in a hospital and feeling so dead. And that came right after you said about documenting, and I'm reading The White Witch of Tenerife, and it's just like, whoa. And I have no idea what I'm talking about right now, but this moment is just so many pieces coming together. And I still have no idea where this is all going. And I, I hear all the conversations about building game worlds, and I've been fucking trying to build those since 5 years ago, you know, and I have no idea how to do it. And I just keep fucking it up over and over again. And I don't know what to do or how to do it. And I just keep trying.
So Jeff, let's say that this is the edge. Let's say that you reach the edge. You know, modern culture has an edge. And it's not easy to find, because modern culture tries to block it and tries to pretend like it's everything. But modern culture has this thoughtware edge, like the reality edge. And let's say that you're standing on the edge. All right, let's say that. So what can you just like, I know that you get that you don't get it. At the same time, if you get it that you're at the edge, then talk. You say, I'm at the edge.
Well, I'm not the only one at the edge. I'm here with you all. Yeah, I'm standing here.
You've got the baton. You're carrying the baton. I'm at the edge. Here's what the edge wants to say. Here's what the edge needs. Here's what's telling you. Here's the guidance from the edge. Just say it.
Yeah, I'm at the edge. And I'm looking at all of you who have been there walking out with me. And I used to see people standing right here where I'm standing and be like, what the fuck is going on? What are you talking about? And I don't, what the edge has to say is like, just don't rush it, you know?
Yes. I'm so glad to be at the edge with you, Jeff, and to be at the edge with everybody else. When you said, I don't know how it goes, this, like, I feel so glad. I feel so glad because what I could imagine is so small and shitty usually. And it's just so limited, and it looks like some kind of old stuff that I've seen before. I'm so glad. I'm so glad you cannot see it. It's like, great, great. Finally. And I've been protecting myself from I've been longing so much. I was in Finnhorn for 10 years and we were like so close and the heart opening, but it was just so mixed with victim and child ego state. And it was the only thing that I really felt like I could really be like myself, or I could really like be messy around other people. And then kind of it's finally happening here for me that I can just, it's that this other part of the mess that is not about being victim, this other part of the edge of trying stuff out. And, you know, you say that you've been fucking it up, and I just, you've been trying stuff out and see where it goes. I've been trying stuff out and see where it goes. And I finally hear, you know, fuck it, fuck the self-image, fuck the self-image completely. It's like, we're doing this. You know, who knows how long I have to live. You know, I might not be alive next year, and I'd rather be having this year of trying stuff out of the edge. There's been nothing that would delight me more, and I'll die, and then I'll die. Just fuck it. It's just... put the foot in the air, just putting the foot in the air. And if there's the ground, there's the ground. And if there's no ground, I fall to the ground. There's just the ground to hit. There's nothing else. There's just the ground to hit. And the swamp is not the ground. The swamp is moving away from the ground. It's making stories about the ground. It's making problems that you're hitting the ground. There's no problem in hitting the ground. It's just ground. So fall into the ground. With me. With us. With me too. So, Isabel, you're still invited to here's come the to thing. The bridge house.
It turns out that the edge is a lot bigger than they want you to think. It's all the way around. It isn't like a little tiny edge over here. It's like there's lots of place at the edge. So just because, you know, Vera's hogging her place at the edge, you know, or Jeff, you know, it's like plenty of room at the edge for you. And then
we're just making it bigger.
Property. We're selling property at the edge. Edge front property. You can have your place at the edge.
Next culture advertising.
I just want to say one, I want to confess one thing though. That I thought I had to choose that's between being on book. The edge.
Vera, that's the title of your book, Confessions.
Face of Sophia. Okay. I thought I had to choose between being with or being close to someone and being at the edge. I don't even remember how I got that in my head, but I know in my body that I just doesn't matter why right now. It's I thought I had to choose that. I was like, I'm either at the edge, I'm riding the edge, or I'm with people, but I can't do both. I cannot do both. And I've been trying to like the edge, fuck everything else. And I've been missing out on so much, not so much being with you. And I'm done with that. That's it. That's it.
I bet you want to say that.
Yeah, I'm touched by what Vera's sharing, especially about being at the edge and being with others. Yeah, I'm also afraid of being able to make it some kind of lone wolf extreme sport to be on the edge and yeah, I'm looking forward to be with the Brit house on the edge because, yeah, sometimes I also get lost in this. Why am I not with my neighbors or my house roommates? And I'm in the women starting over instead, or meeting with my bridge house or my three cell. And yeah, if there's this idea of I can only have this context within the context, or if I'm too ambitious about things or believing that I won't stay here or be here, or if this is not my village, or can I create a village anywhere I go? When I cavitate the space, when my bright principles thrive, are there any limits to where I'm creating these spaces? Yeah, what I was listening to was opening up a lot of questions to me.
So Habet, I feel
I feel fear to face this question of
how bad.
I need to choose between being at the edge or being with. Yeah.
So I feel fear. That part was true. And then you went up in your head again and you were going to try to glue something on. Okay, it's not about that. You know, all that head stuff is not it. So go back to your heart, go back to the thing that said, I feel scared. It's better to say, I feel scared, and then let that thing talk. Let that talk. Don't go try to figure it out in your head. Okay, stay down, try again, shift go. I don't figure it out before. You can't say that.
She's scared too.
Does go to. Say it again. You can do this. Say it again. It's new stuff, Habet. It's really scary. I feel
I feel fear to let this happen and to communicate to you about my fear that is going on right now. It's basically about being staying in connection through this.
We don't need to know what it's about. We just wanted to talk to us. Looking at us and go, I feel scared because I bet that fear is there all the time. And you go away from it. And then we don't get to be with you. Try again.
Look at one person, Habet, and tell them.
I feel fear because I don't know if you will get what I'm saying and if I get what I'm feeling.
Keep going back. Keep going back to that. Say it. Hear that. Yes, it's a sensation. Stay with the sensation. Yes.
I feel fear to not know, to not know what's going on and to have these sensations in my head and my heart, in my throat.
Keep looking at us while you're saying that, Habet. Try to get it that we're with you. You're doing super. You're doing super. Just keep staying with the sensations and let that talk.
Yeah, it's like getting dizzy and not...
Like,
I feel...
I feel fear, and this fear is...
I feel afraid.
Kind of
scared.
I'm afraid that reality is melting, or my sensation is giving... I'm having this sensation that reality is melting.
Yes.
A fear that reality is melting. Yes. Keep going.
Tell us the next thing.
Yeah,
I feel fear to discover something beyond my imagination.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Yeah. You've let it melt about 1% so far. Just keep letting it melt. We want to listen until it melts about 13%. Just keep going.
I feel fear to realize that it's not like I thought it would be.
Yeah, anybody who wants to, you can do this right along with Habet. Just do it right along with her. Keep going, Habet. The sensation.
That I get lost into something else.
Yeah.
I'm not used to find orientation in.
You're 3% already. Keep going.
Keep letting the fear speak.
I feel fear that it takes all over my body. It takes all over in all my bodies.
And you're at 6%. Keep going. Keep saying, I feel afraid. Not I feel fear. I feel afraid. It's different. I feel scared. It's different.
Yeah, I feel scared. And...
It's the first time we could see your eyes, Habet. Mm-hmm. That's the first time we could see your eyes. I don't know how long. It's the first time we could see your eyes in so long. Mm-hmm. Keep going.
And keep going.
Yeah, I feel scared because I noticed that in this aliveness and presence, I don't feel sick anymore. I don't sense the sickness in my physical body the way I did before.
I feel scared. Say it. Keep going.
Mm-hmm. Keep going.
I feel scared to notice how much I'm lost in some stories about reality instead of what I'm experiencing.
Keep going.
8%. Keep going.
Yeah, I feel scared to trust my body that much instead of my stories about what's going on.
Yeah, 9%. Keep going.
I feel glad to have more air now to speak.
Yes, 10%. Keep going. Stay in the sensation.
Yeah.
So I want to go back to this narrow feel breath.
I didn't get the feeling.
Yeah.
I feel
joy of feeling more.
I feel glad. Like, see, I feel glad.
All over my face. I feel glad feeling more.
I bet, are you okay feeling Are you okay to feel glad? Do you know a Habet who can feel glad like this? Is Habet okay to feel glad, actually? Not the concept of glad, mm-hmm. not the idea of glad, just this.
Yeah, it makes me dizzy. It's like having a lot of air. I sense that I have a lot of... I can breathe more.
But are you okay? Is that okay?
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Habet. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah.
Hello, Habet.
Hello, Habet.
Hello, Habet.
Hello, Habet.
Hello. Hello, Isabel.
Does anybody else need anything right now? Antonio, you have an elephant story for us.
It was in contrast with what Beth...
Just tell us the elephant story.
The elephant story threw me in a big emotion of that loneliness of that huge, beautiful animal without having anybody to speak with.
Oh.
And denied to have a child. And the resources we have here together. And when Beth was speaking, I felt so wealthy, so I felt so glad. And he sent me to this incredible emotion of sadness, of solitude, of this dignity of this big animal.
Oh,
being able to share. And what we have here, to listen to all of you. Really makes my day.
Hello, Antonio.
Yes.
I think that we're going to end here for tonight, today, for now. Any last words from anybody?
Just want to let the group know I'm scared to show up in this space because I don't show up like the other men do.
Good reason. I mean, you know, you can use any reason you want, but reasons are about 10 cents a dozen, by the way. So if you run out of reasons, we spend.
I feel scared of being ostracized for not being the way I see the other men accepted as being.
Well, and Chloe is the police officer for this space. And she's the one who sends people away when they're not showing up like all the other people. So, and she's really close to sending me out. So just tell me where you're going to go when she kicks you out and I'll meet you there.
I'll be in good company. Gotcha.
I'm not trying to be cynical or facetious or anything like that. Just welcoming you to the conversation.
I'm scared of going to Poland, and that seems to be where what I need to attend is happening.
Poland's not so bad. They got really good knedlicki and these kind of pancake things and soup. Soup.
I've been to Bali, and getting to Poland is twice as complicated and difficult as getting to Bali.
there are five times as many edge workers there.
So what I need to do is figure out how to go to Portugal and then take the train to Poland, and that would probably work best.
Yeah,
just make a summer of it.
You can walk.
Yeah, you can walk.
Hitchhike.
We did it backwards.
Cycle.
Alrighty then. I'm gonna not say anything else, but thank you so much for being here and being together.
Thank you.
See you, Ingrid. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye, Ingrid.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye.